the second week of the cultural apologetics class. I have it listed as critical theories. I'm going to be continuing with the lesson from last week. And I know last week's lesson was really dense. Raise your hand if it just seemed like you were drinking from the fire hose last week. Yeah, I felt like I was just spraying a fire hose at y'all and praying that something stuck.
Yeah, the one attached to the
truck. Oh yeah, like the ones they put airplanes out at the airport. Yeah, coated y'all with foam and like said, okay, have fun driving home after this. Yeah, I was really tempted to take last week's class and turn it into 2 weeks' class, but I didn't know how much of that y'all could tolerate before going. Like, I've had enough of this. What's that?
Now we know how much we can tolerate.
Yeah, but anybody who's a veteran in my classes know that I tend to push the classes a little bit. And that's the good thing is I've not had any complaints, and I've had a lot of really good questions follow up. So before I step into this new lesson, does anybody have any questions from last week? Any kind of concerns, anything that like that you went home going, what in the world was Thomas talking about when we left?
I'll be honest with you, I have to go back over all of it.
Okay. Yeah, and I do apologize. The audio for last week looks like it was lost.
No, I just point the handout.
Okay.
I didn't get a handout. I have to go back over.
You do bring up a point, something I do want to remember. Okay, so I forgot. There's a tradition we had in the first class. I encourage and I welcome and I really want y'all to come in with questions, and I want to see dialogue going on between class. But what I don't want, and we know, is to get off the rails into a tangential subject. So what I've done in the previous classes is if our discussion gets us off ground and we can't get back on board, I assign you a 2-page essay on the topic you're wanting to talk about, and then I'll go in and critique the essay. So, yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I need the door open because I don't think the air conditioner.
I dropped it down to 72. Farrell, could you check it to see if it's going? It's in the our Sunday school class.
If there's nobody out in the hall.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah. You have a good point, Evelyn. We typically have a full load, and now we're in summer. I have to remember that.
I just dropped it down to 68.
All right. Feels more like 79, 80.
If both doors, this room and the one that the thermostat's in, are open, then it circulates.
Probably.
Yeah.
Both the doors?
Because we had to do that during UBS. Like, don't shut that door.
Yeah. Well, I'm thinking about moving this out into Reed Hall. Because we don't have a lot of programs going on in the summer, and it's just generally
it
nice.
It does get
there.
Nice. The air circulates a lot better in there, especially if you have fans going.
In Reed Hall?
Oh, yeah. It's amazing. Like on men's Bible studies,
yeah.
On Mondays,
yeah.
We never have an issue with.
All right.
We're talking about guys that have worked all day.
Well, I'll ask Mike and see what he thinks about us being in there next week, especially if we have everybody who's out sick today come back next week. And last week's class, we were like sardines in a can here last week.
Yeah, are they sick? Or?
No, this is Levi's sick with the Stalkins. I don't know what's going on with the Brants, but they typically, yeah. So.
I do have something to kind of add since we're going into this critical theory and it touches on these issues. You know, the Bible talks about this in Isaiah, the third chapter.
Mm-hmm.
Talks about it in Romans, the first chapter.
Mm-hmm.
Paul goes into it. I don't want to say like a whole book of First and Second Corinthians. There are definitely large sections where he talks about bad leaders and what the effects of it are, and the effects of it a lot.
Yeah,
and in
Paul's context, he was typically addressing Judaizers or Gnostics in those days. So there are some very good parallels, is all I'm going to tell you on that. We are going to be addressing that later in class. But one of the best lines of scripture we have, I do believe, is in Luke. And this is when you have Jesus coming to visit Mary and Martha, and Mary ends up anointing Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And then at that point in time, you had, Judas Iscariot complaining to Jesus about how many people they could have fed with the cost of the perfume. Yes. And Jesus simply answers him, "The poor will always be with you, but the Son of Man will only be with you for a short while." So to me, that is the best line of scripture we have against any kind of Marxist or socialist economic theory, that you're not going to be able to equalize economic outcomes. You're always going to have the disadvantaged. It's just, in what way are they going to be marginalized or disadvantaged, or, you know, as we know, the poor? You know, are they going to be poor and poor financially, poor in spirit, but even so, poor financially, they may be subsidized, but will their choices to live promote good outcomes, or will the government have to restrict the choices that they have so then they become poor in liberty? So we're combating human nature and human sinful nature, and that's one of the things that Marxist theory never takes into account, except for when they are the inventors of what sin is. So
are we looking at the actual, we're looking at just the way, like, what actual critical theory actually is?
Or yes.
Makes the church
both. Because, okay, the reason why we're taking this deep dive is to be able to address the theory. You have to know it.
Okay.
And this is one of the things that we're going to be going over even in this lesson, is if we just go out and say CRT, cultural Marxism, the people who are adherents to the theory are going to play definitional games. We don't do CRT. We're not Marxists. And what they mean is they don't do CRT. They may do some sort of something rebranded, some sort of different activism, may fall under a different name, but in all intents and purposes, it's the same thing. Or the Marxist, cultural Marxist, will end up saying that we're not Marxist because they don't follow pure Marxist theory as espoused by his original writings in the 19th century. They follow like an evolved theory that's 100, you know, 150 years evolved. They're not Marxist, but they are definitely of the Marxist genealogy. So definitional games. And then within, for the most part, rank and file people, they're going to be just trying to say you're using these terms as a bludgeon, a cudgel to beat your opponent with, but you don't know exactly what's going on. And I'm just going to preface this because this is something that I was going to, there's a little area where I'm going to be iterating this matter. But anytime I run into somebody who's an adherent to these theories, I don't name the names of these things. I won't say Marxist. I won't say critical race theory. I don't even say critical theories. I will address the theory itself, because once they know that you have an idea of these terms and these words, they're going to use them against you. They're going to parody you with them. They're going to use argumentational techniques. They're going to be having you constantly scrambling around going, where the heck did I find myself defending this idea that has nothing to do with what I'm talking about? So they are the activists who in this program are very skilled debaters, but they don't follow the same logic you follow. They do not follow modern Western rationalism. And that's what we're going to be covering today. So that's why I'm going to be teaching you the theory as much as is possible, so that when you see it, you're able to confront it and be able to realize that it's like a hydra. You cut off one head and another grows to replace it and starts attacking you. So this is a very difficult topic. And to lead this lesson off, I wanted to start out with a wonderful statement. Y'all are probably going to think of the movie that's very attributed to, but it's a quote by Charles Baudelaire. The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world that he didn't exist. And I state that because what we're dealing with is literally a ghost. Something that comes in, an apparition that has no name, no definition, no form, yet is able to transform what's around it. Okay, so let's go ahead and get on into this. So cultural Marxism, we're as segueing it from last week, cultural Marxism rebranded for the mainstream. So critical theory has a narrow and a broad meaning in philosophy and the history of social sciences. Critical theory in the narrow sense designates several generations of German philosophers and social theorists in the Western European Marxist tradition known as the Frankfurt School, which we covered last week. Okay, according to these theorists, a critical theory may be distinguished from a traditional theory according to a specific practical purpose. A theory is critical to the extent that it seeks human emancipation from slavery, acts as a liberating influence and works to create a world which satisfies the needs and powers of human beings. Because such theories aim to transform. Because such theories aim to explain and transform all the circumstances that enslave human beings, many critical theories in the broader sense have been developed. They have emerged in connection with many social movements that identify varied dimensions of the domination of human beings in modern societies. In both the broad and narrow senses, however, a critical theory provides a descriptive and normative basis for social inquiry aimed at decreasing domination, increasing freedom in all their forms. So this is directly from the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy. And what I'm trying to do is pull as many of these quotes out of source material and neutral material so you'll have it at hand and people can't say you're just gaslighting or strawmanning the argument. And probably defining terms for people who might not be familiar with everything. Normative just means dealing with ought statements. It's ethical. Something dealing with how we should act in that way. So
what's the definition of the word critical?
Critical just means to critique. So the critical theories based out of Marxism are a ruthless critique of Western culture.
Means to critique.
Mm-hmm.
So here it says that critical Marxism is rebranded in the mainstream.
Mm-hmm.
So where it says like seeks a human emancipation from slavery.
Mm-hmm.
We know that that's not what it does, but this is what it states it does. Is that what you're
saying? You're thinking of slavery as in the terms of chattel slavery as expressed in the South and pre-Civil War. Terms, okay, you're going to get used to this.
Yeah.
Definitions don't mean what you think they mean in critical theory. Slavery just means any kind of oppression.
Okay, so kind of...
Yes.
So it's not me owning another person.
It's just you having privilege, power over another person. Whether that power and privilege is inherent, like if you have money or position, or is it just by nature of
this is where, so this
who
is
you were born as?
White privilege.
Exactly. Exactly, which we're going to get into. Exactly. We're going to get into that just further down the line. So, yeah.
Okay, so now if you look at this historically, you take out the traditions, all of these things that it says it's supposed to do, Christ did that.
Wait until we, I'm going to define this. I'm going to break this down into more fine-tuned methodologies. So, did he critique? Yes. The word critique is based on the word to judge. Yeah, he did.
But He sought to emancipate people from the slavery of sin.
Okay. Keep on going.
He acted as a liberating influence. Mm-hmm. No one did more to advance the status of women than Jesus did.
Of course.
And works to create a world that satisfies the needs and powers of human beings by setting us again. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So you could put those...
All right, well, in a later class, I'm going to be teaching you about liberation theology. It's Christian theology as informed by Marxism, where they take these concepts and turn them into very Marxist ideas. But yeah, did Christ do all these things? Yeah. But what does slavery mean in the terms of what you said, from sin? Liberation theology doesn't think it means of sin. It means from power structures. So you're always going to have to be looking in. The traditional part is pre-Marxist, and then the critical part is post-Marxist. An introduction of this dialectical materialism that he's going to be putting in. Remember, everything last week you had the thesis, the antithesis, and then the synthesis. That process is going to run everywhere through critical theory, and that is the function of how their critique works. So
I'm sorry for dragging this on.
No, it's fine.
So where it says, like, works to create a world that satisfies the needs of power and human beings, would that be the perceived needs, or are they actually talking about, you know, shelter, food, water? Or are they talking about perceived needs, like happiness, joy, hobbies or things of that nature.
If it's from the theorists, it's always going to be from power relationships. Are you oppressed or are you the oppressor? If you're oppressed, then
so where it says works to create a world that satisfies the needs and powers of human beings. So
that way there's a very simple term.
He has to have power.
No, there's a very simple term that defines what he's saying in that statement. It's called communism, where everybody's equal. Everybody has an equal share and a portion as distributed by the government. So, and you have to remember, Marxist theory is inherently economic, but it's been transformed into a cultural manifestation by the Frankfurt School. If you remember old Antonio Gramsci from last week. So this is their wordsmithing. They're using terminologies that we use, that we know, that are built into our ethic as Christians, and what they are viruses. They are delivery devices for their methods. So on the outside, they look healthy. Our white blood cells look at them in the system and go, okay, you sound Christian, come on in. But then once they come in, they plug into a cell, drive their RNA into that cell, and replicate themselves through that. And I'm not trying to be by any means making a false characterization or delivering a huge antithetical discourse on the critical theorists, but this is something they themselves compare themselves to as being viruses. In fact, I can't remember the name of the author, but she is a intersectional feminist who would describe critical theory as just that. I think it's Judith Butler, but I'm probably wrong in that. So that's something I'm going to try to drive home with you all. You heard the words of the pastors earlier. They sounded, for the most part, Christianese, right? Once you start understanding the theory, you start seeing the actual statements that they're trying to say. And in Proverbs, Solomon mentions talking out the side of our mouth. You know, that means trying to have a duplicitous meaning as to what we're saying. We're trying to say something outwardly that's good, but under our breath.
So the
yes.
So the so basically you're stating that, okay. This is basically how they break down the individual.
Yeah, oppressed and oppressor. That's always going to be. That is the power dynamic. That is the dialectical materialism in play.
No, I'm just talking about the concept of the individual. This is the way they do it.
Yes, and that I'm trying to drive it back to the terminologies they use, so you can recognize when you see that dialectic, that dialectical playing out.
The oppressed and the oppressor.
Yes.
Got it.
Okay. Any further questions on the slide? And I want you all to ask, because this stuff is pretty dense. Okay, well, I'm going to be moving on then. All right. So the term critical theory commonly causes confusion because it can refer to the Frankfurt School of Marxist Critics, which we covered last week, and which is also known as neo-Marxism or the New Left, or it can refer to the use of other similar but distinct critical social theories, such as those that have roots in postmodernism, which we're going to be covering next week. And these mixed critical / postmodern theories are postcolonial theory, queer theory, critical race theory, which we're going to be dealing with today, intersectional feminism, disability studies, and fat studies. Sometimes this confusion is expressed disingenuously by academics who dislike criticism of critical theories, and sometimes it's expressed sincerely by those whose fields of philosophy have not kept up with the fast development of social justice scholarship. The critical... What?
I'm sorry for her, but you went over this last week, too.
Uh-huh. They being the critical theorists, right?
Yeah, okay. They being critical theorists, they... where is it you said it? There was a part where... We're were talking where they, all those get together and basically come up with a common bad guy and join together. What was that?
Well, I think you're probably thinking of either Antonio Gramsci or Herbert Marcuse, but they are all, if you can imagine like a family tree, they are all of the genealogy of these thinkers. So.
Was it,
Brother, I hate to ask you, but can you flesh out the question and back later? Yeah, because I want to be able to get, all right.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, no worries. Okay, so the critical theory of the Institute for Social Research, which is better known as the Frankfurt School, focused on power analyses that began from a Marxist perspective with an aim to understand why Marxism wasn't proving successful in the Western context. It rapidly developed a post-Marxist position that criticized Marx's primary focus on economics and expanded his views on power, alienation, and exploitation into all aspects of post-Enlightenment Western culture. These theorists sometimes referred to themselves as cultural Marxists and were referred to that way by others, but the term cultural Marxism is now more commonly used to describe a misconception of postmodernism or a certain anti-Semitic conspiracy theory. The big picture and agenda of the Frankfurt School was to marry Marxian economic theory to Freudian psychoanalytic theory in order to explain both the rise of fascism and the reason that the communist revolutions were not taking place in Western democracies as had been predicted. So, and this is something I'm going to be constantly working with you all here is defining terms. And I'm going to be sharing with you something that's called the Encyclopedia of Woke here shortly. And it's, you can spend weeks reading it. It goes into discourses on each of the terms. But what I'm going to be talking about here is what we were talking about earlier, the difference between a traditional theory and a critical theory. So moving on, Max Horkheimer defined a critical theory in direct opposition to a traditional theory in a 1937 piece called Traditional and Critical Theory, whereas traditional theory is meant to be descriptive of some phenomenon, usually social, and aims to understand how it works and why it works that way, which is the scientific method, mind you. A critical theory should proceed from a prescriptive moral vision for society. Prescriptive moral vision means how they think society ought to be. And describe how the item being critiqued fails that vision, usually in a systemic sense. So they start off with their premise, this is what I think it should be, and this is, I'm going to critique it to why it's not following my vision. And then prescribes activism to subvert, dismantle, disrupt, overthrow, or change it. That is generally to break and then remake society in accordance to the particular critical theory's prescribed vision. So as different from traditional theory, scientific theory, you come out with your hypothesis and then you do your observations in the world and then you're able to glean if those observations match or your theory matches the observation. If your theory doesn't match, you discard it and come up with a new hypothesis. This theory starts out with the conclusion. They go out and look in the world if they see their conclusion. If they don't, then the world, there's something wrong with the world. So then they critique the world. Why don't you follow my conclusion? And if it doesn't, then they go out and become activists to try to change the world to meet their conclusion. So they take the scientific method, flip it on its head, and then call it a theory. And I hate to tell you this, a lot of science you hear that comes out in popular media these days is informed by this. STEM has been completely and almost completely invaded by these theories now.
STEMs,
engineering and mathematics.
Engineering and mathematics, and sometimes they put it as STEM and put arts in.
Yeah, which that's part of the critical theorists trying to invade the.
It's very big in the school.
Yeah. So.
Science, technology, engineering, and math.
Yep. Who here read 1984 back in high school? Anybody raise their hand? No. Nobody did? Wow, they don't.
I know Aaron did.
Okay.
I know my brother checked out the book from the library in 1984.
That was required reading when I was in school, and it's about an authoritarian government. Written in 1948, a hypothetical world where there was three authoritarian governments that ruled the entire world. There was no freedom. You had no freedom of thought. The government told you everything. The government revised history to match its vision. And it was take, it was told from the point of view of somebody who worked in what was called the Ministry of Truth, who was which was actually a huge propaganda arm of the government. And his job, he would see the official government truth be changed. And he has a statement in the book saying that if the party told you that 2 + 2 = 5, then you believed 2 + 2 = 5. Not but 2 years. What's that? Yeah, Big Brother's watching. Exactly. Not but, what year is this? 2023. Not but 2 years ago, guess what? There was a push from the left. Any takers? No? 2 + 2 = 5. Arguing with online distinguished mathematicians, guys who held multiple doctorates in mathematics, and these activists had invaded mathematical schools within universities, and they were trying to argue their point how 2 + 2 could = 5. It's here. I hate to tell you this. I don't want this to be so gloomy for you, but we need to be aware. So I wanted to take that little excursion to be able to drive the point home a little bit there. So where were we at? So this use of the word critical is drawn from, okay, here's the definition. I'm sorry, I didn't flip slides quick enough. The use of this word critical is drawn from the Marxist's insistence that everything be ruthlessly criticized, from his admonition that the point of studying society is to change it. Of note, then, a critical theory is only tangentially concerned with understanding or understanding or truth, and I was typing this late at night, so let's skip over that. Critical methodology is then the central object of concern. It is the tool by which social justice scholarship and activism proceeds. So, the critical theories of the Frankfurt School primarily looked at the systems of power in terms of how they exploited the oppressed working class and, more broadly, the everyday citizen or certain everyday citizens as opposed to members of the various elite classes. Speaking very generally, and thus charitably, the purpose of critical theories, including the critical theory of the Frankfurt School, is to make visible the underexamined or invisible presuppositions, assumptions, and power dynamics of society, and question, criticize, and especially problematize them. Indeed, the primary objective of the critical theories is problematization, which means identifying something as problematic, which means it stands against the normative vision adopted by the critical theorists in question, and this, in turn, is understood to mean the support of any unjust assumptions or power dynamics. So there we go, if y'all want to... Yeah, but the problematization is the dialectic in action. So you have your thesis, the problematization is the creation of the antithesis that you then you can put into direct competition with the thesis in order to produce your synthesis. This I'm going to be saying this little three-step program of the dialectic throughout this class, but y'all are going to need to learn to see it take place because it unfolds in so many places. So once I started studying this theory, like around 4 or 5 years ago, I started seeing it everywhere. And then what it really drove home was when, like in conversations with my wife, the table, I'm like, baby, don't you realize what you're saying comes from this school of thought? And I'd have to try to lovingly explain to her, like the way we, like some of the ways we were raised were influenced by these methodologies. And when she started learning what the theory meant, she started seeing it everywhere too. But this is something that it's, as I was talking about in the last sessions, atheism has become the air we breathe in this country, right? It is the natural assumption these days. We've moved into a post-Christian culture. Well, critical theories has become the water we drink, unfortunately. It is, especially within the last 10 years, invaded everything. Hate to say it, but we have to be able to be aware of it now that we know what it's done. So, yay, more happiness in this class. Okay, where are we at? I think I got ahead of myself. I think we talked about, there's problematization. Okay, let me skip back there a little bit. Okay, one of the ambitions of the critical theorists of the Frankfurt School was to address cultural power in a way that allowed an awakening of working class consciousness out of the ideology of capitalism in order to overcome it. Particularly, these theorists had decided that the reason the communist revolution had yet to be successfully spread throughout the West is that something in the liberal Western culture must be preventing it. The goal of critical theory of the Frankfurt School, in that sense, was to identify what those issues were and find ways to dismantle them. As such, the Italian Marxist, Antonio Gramsci's concept of hegemony, meaning the dominance of one particular set of ideas over all others in a society, has been influential on the development of Marxist and post-Marxist critical theory, and also on the development of the structuralist critical methods of postmodernism, which we're going to touch into next week. Among their conclusions is that the dominance of hegemonic ideas in society leads to the marginalization of other ideas, thus preventing change and maintaining oppression.
Dominance of what now?
The hegemonic ideas. And what do you want to give a guess as to what that hegemonic idea is? You mentioned it earlier.
Yeah, it's going to be the.
It's one word.
Oh.
No, well, kind of, yeah, but it's tied to something that they a little bit better.
You're talking about the. It starts with a P.
What? It starts with a W.
Starts with a W?
Yeah.
Oh, because I was thinking of patriarchy.
That's attributed to the concept too. Any guess? You hear it all the time.
W.
W H.
Oh.
Ends with ness.
Whiteness.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the abstracted concept of Western civilization is now called whiteness. The hegemonic power of Western civilization is now called whiteness. So.
The power of Western civilization.
Well, that's what they call it.
What's hegemonic again?
Hegemonic means something that has power over others, especially. So as I said, the U.S., like if we want to look at it in a geopolitical standpoint, the U.S. is the global hegemon. We have power over the entirety of the earth. China is a regional hegemon and growing into a global hegemon. They have huge power over Eurasia at this point in time, and in Africa and South America, and then something like... say Germany, maybe a European hegemon, local hegemon, but that just means you have power over others, whether it be economic, cultural influence. Like you can see American movies everywhere you go. There's a McDonald's in probably every major city in the world, probably save Pyongyang, but yeah, that would be.
Not only that, but this isn't the most white country on earth.
It doesn't matter.
So diverse.
You can have whiteness. Assume whiteness. It's not part of your skin anymore. It's abstracted out. It's been problematized. A black person could suffer from internalized whiteness.
Yeah, like how they call Larry Elder.
The blackface of white supremacy is what they call him.
Yeah. So, okay. And whiteness, that would be equated to white supremacy?
It's one and the same.
An
attitude then? No, it's just. When.
I have a Haitian son, but two Haitians, black, and he's in the army, and he's called Oreo because he's black on the outside, big white on the inside.
Yeah, and that word's been around for decades. I mean, you would have seen that on, what was it? Moving on up to the east side. I forget the name of the show.
Oh,
Jeffersons. Yeah, yeah, he used that term rather liberally in that show, but it's. Whiteness is basically the culture of Western Europe, the culture that, and this is where the post-colonialism is going to come into play, colonized the majority of the world within, say, the rush to Africa. They colonized, Britain colonized nearly the whole Indian subcontinent. European powers colonized nearly all of Asia, all of South America was at some point in time colonized and still is to some degree. But it's the problematization, okay? So we have this is how it works. You have a concept, right? Western European, right? How do you extract out something? Oh, you take the idea, pull it out, and it always ends up with the word ness at the end of it. So, and that's when you know you've got a problematized abstract concept and you're working with critical theory, is they'll talk about, I've been studying queer theory, and lately and all the words there typically have something to do with a body part, so I'm trying to keep it clean. So so the patriarchy would be an abstracted concept out of everything. But then that would be something like maleness or something of the nature. So the whiteness is the concept of Western European hegemonic power. That's all I can say. We're going to expand upon that a little bit further in our class on intersectionality, which is going to cover these ideas in great depth. So I wanted to kind of answer your question without getting us off the track a little bit too much, okay? Any other questions before I proceed? All right, with that being said, where was I at? Okay, we're there. All right, so critical theories in a broader sense are largely understood to be the critical study of various types of power relations within myriad aspects of culture, often under a broad rubric referred to generally as cultural studies. These move the question of power dynamics away from generalized hegemony and into the various hegemonies created and maintained by and over the various identity groups in society. These, and once again, this is this list, and you're going to get used to this list. These include post-colonial theory, queer theory, which queer theory is built completely around problematization of the normal, critical race theory, intersectional feminisms, the critical theories of ableness and fatness, ableism and fatness, so that means people with like disabilities. So you have power and privilege if you can walk and you have all your faculties. They are to be found within many disciplines and subdisciplines within the theoretical humanities, including cultural studies, media studies, gender studies, ethnic, race, whiteness, black studies, sexuality, LGBTQ, and trans studies, post-colonial, indigenous, and decolonial studies, disability studies, and fat studies. Critical theories of various kinds are also found within, but not necessarily dominant over, other fields of the humanities, social sciences, and arts, including English, literature, sociology, philosophy, art, history, and particularly pedagogy, the theory of education. So that's something we're going to get into a little bit more in depth here. Oh, wait, I needed to back up a little bit here, unless I got my notes. No, okay, I'm good. The use of critical theories within the disciplines leads to a highly theoretical, ideological, and interpretive approach to culture, artistic, and identity issues, all of which are to be studied in a critical way, not necessarily rigorously. The meaning of the word criticism here is specific, not as one might expect it to be used in common parlance, and refers to seeking out ways in which problematics, according to some normative moral vision for society, there's that problematization again, arise within functional systems, particularly the systems of social and cultural power in liberal Western and scientific settings. There is, in the critical method, there is within the critical method, I guess it's gone. Oh, there it is. Okay, sorry about that. No need, okay, there is in the critical method no need to understand these concepts or structures, only to pick at the ways in which they can be construed to be imperfect. Yes, brother.
So a good example of problematization would be that 2 + 2 = 5.
Yeah, because the way they'll
make a problem out of something that would be no issue with.
Yeah, and yeah, exactly. And a lot of the arguments were typically something along the lines of math as we know it originates in white Western European settings. You're using reason and logic, and you're going well. Then the white people appropriate it from Islam, and then you're going to have all these different kind of. If you use reason and logic, you're going to have it turned against you. So, and the methods that they use is that, and then they also you discount other ways of knowing. You probably didn't take Mayan math into account. You probably didn't take Native American. Trying to think of a tribe, Anastase math into account. You didn't think feminism into account when you did your math. They literally say stuff like that, or they will use a bunch of examples of how, like, say, 1.9999999 and 1.999999 equal 4.99998, and you basically have 2 + 2 = 5 or something along that line. But they move the goalposts. You think you're arguing with logic. They're not. They're starting out with their conclusions as being true. So no matter what you try to do to convince them, all you're doing is just spinning your wheels deeper and deeper into the sand.
So if
I give you $2 and $2, will you give me $5?
Okay. So, it sounds that simple, right? But then they're going to turn the argument against it, and they're going to turn it into an economic standpoint.
So
they will turn that against you, like saying something, are you trying to say that I don't have the means to take care of myself? Are you using your white guilt to try to assuage the fact that I come from an economically disadvantaged background? You think
no,
you're...
But
you see what I'm trying to say. You're
yeah.
going down a linear rational thought. They're not going to do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what you're saying is they start out with their perception of truth.
Let's hang truth on a hanger
till
probably about the sixth class. Truth doesn't mean the same thing to them either.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to understand. So, but you said they start out with the basis of truth.
They start out with their conclusions.
They start out with conclusions. Got
yeah.
It.
Yeah, because once you start using that T word, you're imposing your epistemic, which epistemic means theories of knowledge, how you know things, what we kind of touched into last week. You're imposing your epistemic hegemony over them.
Imposing theirs over
on. Yeah, you're starting to see the irony in it, right? Remember, I told you their logic is very circular, but once you enter that circle, woe be you getting out of it. So you basically have to kick the legs out of whatever is holding their little circular logic together.
Okay, I'll be honest with you. That statement right there just made this class make sense.
Okay, that's good.
Before then, I was kind of lost.
Yeah, but that makes sense. Yeah, but did you notice that's how I typically debate atheists online or other people's. I undermine their whole argument. I don't engage them directly on their arguments. I know they're all traps.
Yeah, to be honest, whenever I argue, they always come at you. They start with a conclusion.
Hmm?
They all do.
Yeah, well, most online atheist trolls, and yeah, I'm talking to you, have been completely subordinated into woke ideologies. The ones who haven't are now typically working with Christians.
Yeah.
So
that's what makes it circular, is because they come at you already. I'm not trying to go off on you.
No.
Okay, so with any type of critical theory,
mm-hmm.
They come at you with where they've already drawn a conclusion.
Mm-hmm. And they're just seeking the problem.
They're working back off of it. They're working from the back. They're starting with the conclusion so that they could break you down, because you're starting with logic and reason. If you start with logic and reason,
it's not the if doesn't even have to be there. They don't even recognize logic and reason as valid. They use that as what's called the master's tools, the white man's means of dominating society. So you got to throw logic and reason out the window when you're dealing with them. You have to learn their methods, how not to get caught in their traps. And if you try to use logic and reason, you're in their trap. So what you have to do is painful discourse, and it takes a long time to be able to dismantle the foundations of what they're trying to argue with. And you have to be careful enough to not let them know you're doing it. I've had debates. I had a very long, probably 4-hour discourse with a gentleman in one of my, he was in my, what do you call it, my Christian college. Totally bought into all this stuff. I couldn't address any of the issues by name. I had to address everything tangentially. I couldn't by any means make any accusations. All I had to do was call them out on their lines of reasoning and let it play out. Get them to the point where they were contradicting themselves, call them out on their self-contradictions, and in the end, they go, well, that's just the way it is. And it's very, very difficult, very painful, but ultimately, you'll know when you're dealing with an activist. If you're dealing with an activist, you're going to be in a whirlpool really quick. If you're dealing with somebody who has just been introduced to these ideas, have no clue what they mean, it's just something they've been taught through their school, their work, even their churches, you do have a chance. They still have a beachhead in reason and rationality. But if you're dealing with an activist, yeah.
Good luck.
Yeah.
I have a question for you, too.
As far as arguing back, I found, because I used to go to school and with a number of people who really embraced that, the whole critical race thing, and we would get into these debates. And I found as an older, white, middle-class woman, I was labeled as, like, there's no way you're going to get it. You will not understand. You just won't get it. So all I could do was go experientially. I, too, grew up poor. I, too, understood that. Like,
yeah.
I'm not that far from you, but that's the only thing I could do.
Yeah, well,
the
thing is, I mean to cut you off, but yeah, that's going to be tied into something we're going to get into later. It's called standpoint epistemology. And what that means is you've heard like these ways of knowing, a feminist way of knowing, indigenous ways of knowing. And you, due to your intersectional hierarchy, which is, I'm going to use that term now, that means you already have power and privilege that you don't have access to the knowledge they have. So you have, number one, no right to speak of what they're talking about. And unless you become critical, you develop this critical consciousness through becoming an activist to the system, will you ever even be able to speak on these subjects? So you can't even talk to them about their theory unless you are an adherent to their theory. You can't speak to them about their theology until you've converted into their religion. Yeah, but unfortunately, some of us are stuck with this at work. A lot of times this is being driven by our employers, our schools, and you are forced to participate. And I'm not talking about where you just have to sit there in a seat and just be present. You have to use their theory and you have to subject yourself to it. A lot of people are going through this. I've counseled a lot of my other fellow Christian students and people I've discipled who, like at big employers in town, have been forced through these DEI sessions where they've been forced to admit their privilege and make atonement. I've had a professor at a Christian college get down on his knees and apologize to an African-American girl in that class. And little did he know, she was probably the most conservative person in that class. 20-year plus Army veteran. And he's like, what are you doing? I don't even follow this theory. And then expecting the rest of us Anglos, as he called us, in the way I sneaked out of it, I did not like the answer I gave. I'm like, I'm not Anglo, I'm Irish. Don't call me that, you oppressor. I used his theory against him. But I was so taken by the fact he was doing this. I'm like, oh my God, is this happening? Oh God, not now, not in a Christian school, but it took place. And
according to what you're saying, so when they want to drive you into an argument from authority.
No.
In other words, the reason I say that.
No.
I knew you were going to say no, but the reason I say that is because they want to drive it to you. You can't know what it's like to be me because you don't have either the same gender ideology, race.
There is that, but yeah, it's you're thinking argument from an authority is would be considered.
You don't have a math. You're not a biologist. So
you see it. You see it now in the public discourse, especially within politics. Yeah, but an argument from authority is an informal fallacy within debate. You can argue from authority, right? Yeah, like yeah. If you're referencing somebody who's the top of their field, yeah, argument from authority is great. So and so says, and I'll give you their argument over the case. Yeah, you can do it. But this is something meaning. That the way you experience the world, their epistemology, I gotta use a big word, but it's just their theories of knowledge are built more around perceptions, experience than anything else. And in truth, there's a triad to how we can know anything in the world, and they only focus on one. And then they try to say the Western world focuses on one, which that would be something like scientific theories actually use all three of the triad, but they try to say that we just use propositional knowledge and we try to force world into these categories, and they're trying to break down all the categories. And then these categories that we build to explain the world are used to dominate and oppress other people.
Okay, but if you're not putting things in categories, then why are there so many letters in the LB?
Yeah, well, take Marxian thought that you would go through You would go through a revenue. No, this is very pertinent. This is very pertinent. But so yeah, it's either circular logic, which does very much exist within the theory, but this is very much Marxian. So you would have the revolution that overthrow the oppressors in society, and then you would have the I just went brain dead. The authoritarian government of the proletariat. I can't think of the word that Marx used, but the idea of like an all-powerful government, but where the oppressed people become the rulers of society, and then do distinctions break down. Right now, they're in the revolutionary phase. They're taking over society, so right now they can have their distinctions. Once the communist utopia, or now which we consider the critical consciousness, has reached and taken over the whole world, then those distinctions break down and everybody will be equally, let's say, liberated. So that's the Marx in what you're asking. So it's always going to go back to Marx. And as I'm going to be building in this class, it goes back much, much further than Marx, and something that's plagued Christianity since before there was Christianity. Okay, and this is what we were talking about earlier. Where was I at? I'm on slide 11. Okay. I'm trying to focus where I'm at. Okay. The focus on identity, experiences, and activism rather than the attempt to find truth, what we were talking about, leads to conflict with empirical scholars and undermines public confidence in the worth of scholarship that uses this approach. Because critical theories nearly always begin with their conclusion, their own assumptions about power dynamics in society, how these things are problematic, and the need for the disruption or dismantling, and then seeks to find ways to read them into various aspects of society. The body of scholarship that has been growing for the last 50 years has become towering and an impressive mountain with very insecure foundations.
So.
Meaning it's all based on Marxist presuppositions, and it's highly self-referential, meaning it's not based on actual observations of phenomenon in the world. Remember, they start out with their assumptions and their conclusions, and then tried to force the world to match their theory, rather than our theory based on observable, known, objective reality, especially within Christianity. That objective reality being embodied in God. Okay, so we're moving next into applying the critical theories. And this is one of the first things we're going to run into is called deconstruction, something that's very much happening within Christian circles. And this is, Farrell, I know, Farrell, you have experience in dealing with progressive Christians and progressive Christianity, and something that I'll probably share with y'all on how to study into progressive Christianity, which is Christianity as has been invaded by these critical theories. And deconstruction is the term that the progressive Christians will use to deconstruct from their traditional patriarchal Western hegemonic ways of knowing God, and more into an experiential way of knowing God. So, but deconstruction affects everything that the critical theories touch. So I'm going to get in touch base. And I know you've got a question.
No.
All right, so I'm going to get into defining terms here. So most simply, deconstruction is a mode of philosophical and literary analysis derived from the work of philosopher Jacques Derrida, which interrogates basic philosophical categories or concepts. Mind you, this is a very postmodern field. I wanted to jump in because this is, we'll skip ahead with a little portion of postmodernism, because this is very necessary for the rest of this class, which we are, next week's class is going to be all about postmodernism. And if you think this is weird, wait for postmodernism. So deconstruction arises in philosophy as reading of philosophical texts against the grain of the philosophical tradition, contesting its hierarchical binary oppositions. There's the dialectic, meaning, form, soul, body, inside, outside, speech, writing, and so on, by exploring how they are already deconstructed, shown by the constructions, by the texts that assert or depend on them. And then Derrida's writings were at one time primary referent to the term deconstruction, but deconstruction, which was already engaged with philosophy, psychoanalysis, and literary studies in 1982, became an extraordinarily powerful intellectual paradigm whose exfoliation in myriad fields of humanities and social sciences marked the intellectual life of the 1980s and 90s. The term deconstruction has come to designate a range of radical theoretical enterprises in fields such as law, architecture, theology, feminism, gay and lesbian studies, ethics and political theory, in addition to philosophy, psychoanalysis, and literary and cultural studies. Though diverse, these enterprises share a critical dismantling of the conceptual oppositions that had previously been regarded as fundamental to the disciplines.
That would be a lot like so if I'm a critical theorist, then I would approach it from the conclusion that because God created everybody, gays are born gay, therefore God, no?
No. Okay. Deconstruction started out, this is interesting. Anybody here into literature? I know there's more than one in here, and I'm looking at one that she's being shy. Okay. It started out in literary analysis, right? So what they did was they would read a book and they'd say, okay, what if the bad guy's the good guy in this book? Okay, let's rewrite this book to where the bad guy's a good guy. And the first experience I had in that was in high school when I got assigned a book called Grendel. Which Grendel, if you know it, was the offspring of the witch and Beowulf and the epic Beowulf. So it retold the story of Beowulf through the perspective of Grendel. And Grendel was an enlightened yet oppressed person, oppressed by the Anglo-Saxons. And it recast the Anglo-Saxons as being bumbling, patriarchal, violent. So I got to do a book report on that back in 1991. And so my first introduction into postmodern literary deconstruction. And little did I know at that point in time that theory was being applied to society. So the concept of recasting the bad guy to the good guy. How many times have we seen anti-hero movies within the last 20 years, or movies where the hero has now been denigrated into the enemy, and now who was the enemy is now lifted up and cast as a misfortunate victim who thus should be the ruler. And my biggest thing, if you all have seen the new Amazon reboot of The Lord of the Rings under Rings of Power, that's exactly what happens, where Sauron, the most evil character within The Lord of the Rings trilogy, ends up becoming a tragic figure who ends up joining forces with the hero in that movie or the series.
Another and perhaps easier read and a little more fun would be the fairy tales told from the standpoint of the Big Bad Wolf.
There you go. Exactly. These are all literary deconstructions, and this is where it started out. Relatively harmless, but it was Marx in thought, because Derrida was a Marxist. He took the theory, applied it to literary analysis, and then that gets re-injected back into society. So that's why I wanted to move on to the next slide here, critical theory applied to hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is something you'll hear a lot in Christian circles. It typically means the interpretation of biblical text. It actually means the interpretation of any texts, and it could mean the interpretation of data. Scientists use it, hermeneutics, in their interpretation of observational data from their experiments, or other, say, theoreticians who wrote stuff and they'll use it to try to figure out what they meant, or it could mean just the typical interpretation of any text. But hermeneutics is central in the fact that the only way that we humans can transport what's going on in one mind to the next is through the use of language. And hermeneutics applies to all language. So thus it becomes something that invades the only way we have of being able to connect with each other. So moving on to slide 14, deconstruction in its purest form was a practice of reading in order to pick apart the binary oppositions by which we understand our world. Fact and fiction, science and art, male and female, to be radically skeptical of categories on principle, and to doubt that words could ever refer straightforwardly to things in the real world or convey stable meaning. It relied on the assumptions of structuralism, which says that cultures are reliant upon structures of meaning, largely maintained through language, and less well through symbolism, and of social constructivism, which holds that societies construct reality with the way they understand it and talk about it. To practice deconstruction is to pick at these categories in words and attempt to show them as inherently flawed, problematic, or absurd. So, the high deconstructive phase of postmodernism was most closely associated with Jacques Derrida, who was most famous for the deconstructive approach, passed in the late 1980s. However, its practices of nitpicking and applying radical skepticism of categories, it's not on the slide, I'm sorry, stable meaning and objective truth, as well as its commitment to social constructivism and to various forms of cultural studies, it is most strongly seen in queer theory and intersectional feminism, where the stable categories of male and female sexes were regarded as oppressive, and where gender roles as well as race relations are assumed to all have been constructed by dominant groups in society in order to repress marginalized groups. Thus, when one is asked to dismantle one's whiteness or masculinity or avoid heteronormative, and heteronormative just means what we would have called normal, or cisnormative, which means close to normal, language. So we have to stop talking. We can't use the words we used to use. We have to use preferred pronouns. We can't use any words that may or may not convey any sort of perceived oppression, perceived offense, or even be tied into anything that can convey those ideas. So this follows from the social constructivist views, or more accurately, the post-structuralist view, and draws particularly from Derridean thought, which sees reality, or at least social reality, and its injustices as being the result of power dynamics that are hidden in discourses or ways of talking about things. Structuralism holds roughly that one must understand the structure of systems within society to understand them, and post-structuralism tends to take the view that the elements of these structures are in many ways arbitrary and thus can be deconstructed and changed. Theory, when I'm going to use the word theory, it just means critical theories. Theory would suggest that by altering the discourses, by deconstructing them and the power dynamics they carry, one can alter social reality, overcome oppression, and achieve justice. Who here remembers the big wave of what we call political correct speech some 30, 40 years ago? Did anybody remember living through the 80s, 90s? So that was the first wave of this method in our culture. Now we are being reminded of ways of communicating that can no longer be. You hear terms like, instead of female, person who lactates. Because using the term female now promotes cis heteronormativity. So that language has to be removed in order to move the culture to something more in line with their vision of the world.
That's heteronormative.
Hetero, just from the Greek, hetero just means other or another. Normative, that means the concept that there is a binary, or that there's a straight, a normal way of being. It runs opposite to queer theory, which queer theory just tries to deconstruct everything that is normal. Cis normative means it's close to normal. It's something that can be conveyed as something that supports the normal. And those normal are always going to be that which upholds the oppressive systems of power in society. So you're going to have these words thrown at you in time. So I know they sound like a word fool, and they sound like something a crazy gender studies graduate working as a barista in your local Starbucks would say it to you if you forget to address them by their preferred pronouns. But these are the words the activists do use. So, and I'm throwing tons of stuff at you. I know I am, but this is all going to be available to you. And tested the audio, and God willing, this class is going to maintain the audio throughout. So, all right. So in practice, deconstruction is a method by which meaning is either broken down or problematized specifically for the purpose of either showing meaning to be arbitrary or to expose and rearrange the power dynamics believed to be carried by the way words relate to one another. And this is the central part, is what I'm trying to tell you. When you think you're using normal language, when you think you're using normal terms and debating such people, their meanings don't convey the same things. In fact, words only symbolize, they've been separated from their symbols. And I'm trying not to get into too much philosophy here. They have meaning as to the person who's perceiving the meaning. So it's about as nebulous. It's the concept of playing whack-a-mole. You think you're whacked your definition down here, but it pops up, no, oh, I mean this. And then just constantly shifting. So I know this sounds confusing, and it is meant to be that way. I'm not trying to explain this to you, and I'm failing at my terms. This stuff is, I'm going to be honest, I may be failing at explaining this theory to you, but the theory is meant to be confusing.
So that goes back to their saying that words can never really straightforwardly convey ideas.
Yeah. Yeah, it's all words. I do want to get in it, because I will touch into post-structuralism, post-structuralism in the future class. So the study of semiotics, the study of symbols, all words symbolize an actual concept in the world. Like, so cup could be, always refers to a device used for containing liquid that we drink out of, or a table means something that we place things on, like whether it be to eat or to study, so on and so forth. But they take away that relationship between the symbol and that which it represents in the world. And it doesn't represent anything. It only represents what you perceive it to mean. So objective meaning, out the window. That's one of the things you're going to be running into a lot with this. Okay, so moving on. Yes, sir.
If someone, okay, so deconstruction, I'm not understanding the reason why we need to understand deconstruction.
We're going
to
get into it. It's literary breakdowns of concepts, and to be able to understand the meanings within critical theories, you're going to have to understand this problematization, especially in how it's been adapted towards critical race theory. So, and the concepts of that we are trying to address an idea and that we're able to name it, you're not going to be able to do that. I had to set this up to be able to get you ready for the biggest counters you're going to be running into in addressing critical race theory, any critical theory, but you mainly will see it in your debates on critical race theory, and to be able to demonstrate the tactics they use in their debates against you.
Well, they use deconstruction against us.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I've seen you personally use deconstruction against them.
I refer to actual objective terminologies. My main goal when I'm trying to get people, when I'm debating people, and I do this with you all the time, define that term. What do you mean by? Is that correct? Yeah. I'm getting you to try to define your terms. A postmodernist and a critical theorist won't do that. Or they won't hold it to...
They don't care.
That's the psychologization. We're not looking at what their intent is. We're looking at their theory to be able to dismantle it. If you look at their intent, you're going to get knocked off course. Our idea is to address the argument. Once you start psychologizing them, you're in their circle.
Well, what I'm trying to get at is getting someone to think critically about...
You're thinking critically as in, like, you would think critical thinking, applying logic and reason to something. That's not what this critical means. Critical means the problematization, the finding, the taking of the thesis, problematizing it to give birth the antithesis, putting them in direct competition against each other, or the production of the synthesis, and then repeating the process. It's not reason and logic. Yeah.
No, that makes sense.
Okay. And that's
that makes sense. And okay, then, yeah, so I was okay. I was using critical thinking.
Yeah.
To get somebody, because I know they don't care, they don't even care about our religion when they talk to us.
Oh, they'll use it against you.
Yeah, they'll use
it. They'll care as much. What? Oh, no, I need to talk, so I can't be stuffing my face. Oh, but Evelyn, please do. And then I thought they were talking to me. Yeah. Anything that can be used to continue the dialectic will be used. Nothing is out of bounds. They'll even use the dialectic against their own theory. In fact, they promote doing as such. So this is something this is an alien concept, isn't it?
Well, it is for us, because we have an absolute truth. To them, they don't. They can, you could prove them wrong on one point, they just redefine it so that you didn't.
You're getting the idea now. Okay, good, good, good. Let's move on then. All right. So now we're into critical race theory. All right. So, critical race theory is a movement. The critical race theory movement is a collection of activists and scholars engaged in studying and transforming the relationships among race, racism, and power. The movement considers many of the same issues that conventional civil rights and ethnic studies discourses take up, but places them in a broader perspective that includes economics, history, setting, group and self-interest, and emotions and the unconscious. Unlike traditional civil rights discourse, which stresses incrementalism, which is a step-by-step approach to progress, critical race theory questions the very foundations of the liberal order, including equality theory, legal reasoning, enlightenment rationalism, and neutral principles of constitutional law. Sorry, I had that up there the whole time. Excuse me. Oh, no, wait, I had a different one.
I'm going to get to the definition of racism.
Yeah, I'm going to get down to that. Yeah, we've got multiple definitions we're going to be working with. So critical race theory is a scholarly and political approach to examining race that leads to a consequential analysis and profound understanding of racism. It argues as a starting point that the axis of American social life is fundamentally constructed in race. As a result, the economic, political, and historical relationships and arrangements that social actors have to institutions and social processes are all based on race. CRT also argues that as a whole, this idea has been purposefully ignored, subdued, and marginalized in both dominant and public discourse, and that there are serious repercussions that arise from structural blindness, which would be your color blindness. One of the important tenets of CRT is the assertion that race is socially constructed, yet it denotes explicitly and implicitly how power is used and appropriated in society. Now, those are definitions of CRT by actual people who are critical race theorists. So I wanted to be able to take you to primary sources there.
I'm supposed to say that everything is based on race.
Yep. That is probably the best synopsis that I've heard so far. So.
You're welcome.
Thank you. So, all right, class over. Evelyn's teaching now. So critical race theory is a critical theory of race. It distinguishes itself explicitly from previous approaches to race and racism, such as the liberal ones characterizing the civil rights movement of the 1960s. For example, the introduction to the textbook Critical Race Theory, critical race theory is characterized explicitly in these terms. The critical race theory movement is a collection of activists and scholars engaged in studying and transforming the relationship among race, racism, and power. The movement considers many of the same issues that the conventional civil rights and ethnic studies discourse takes up, but places them in a broader perspective that includes economics, history, setting, group and self-interest, and the emotions and the unconscious. I think I'm repeating myself here, but oh well. Unlike traditional civil rights discourse, which stresses incrementalism and step-by-step progress, critical race theory questions the very foundation of the liberal order, including equality theory, legal reasoning, enlightenment rationalism, and the neutral principles of constitutional law. I think I repeated myself there, so sorry about that. So a few salient points stand out on this in this paragraph. First, critical race theory is essentially concerned with power, which holds in a higher regard than truth. Indeed, it holds the postmodernist position that claims that the truth are assertions of power by specific means, which we're going to touch into that next week a lot more. Second, it distinguishes itself from traditional civil rights and instead favors identity politics in the radical sense of identity politics. Third, it is not interested in progress, but revolution. Fourth, it calls into question the very foundations of the liberal order, including equality theory, legal reasoning, enlightenment rationalism, and neutral principles of constitutional law. That positions critical race theory as explicitly anti-Western and, in the narrow context in which it arose and mostly applies, anti-American. Critical race theory favors equity over equality. Does anybody know the difference between the two? Equity and equality?
Yes.
Do you care to share with us, brother?
Yeah. Equality means that we all have an opportunity.
Okay. You've already kind of defined it.
So. Yeah, equal opportunity, and yeah. Then equity means that we're all on the same level no matter what.
Yeah. So
I think the best illustration of that I've seen is where you have kids looking over a fence.
Yeah.
You see the picture of them, and you see. One kid is standing on the ground, and then the others are standing on different level of blocks,
mm-hmm.
so that they could all see over the fence.
Yeah, and then the other one, yeah, it was in the first one where they all are like on the same block, and the shorter kids can't see over the fence. And there's also an extension where they've cut the legs off of the kids, but
so they're all equal in the same height.
Yeah, exactly. Which would be more accurate representation of Marxist as a Marxism is applied, but. Equality means equality of opportunities. Equity means equality of outcomes. In other words, normal equality, we all are given the same tools in order to, let's say, have a the right to, what was it, the freedom, I'm blowing my memory here, the rights as enumerated in the Declaration of Independence, in the pursuit of happiness, yes, thank you. We all are given the equal means, the tools, in order to reach. But the equity term means you will be delivered equal life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In fact, there's no pursuit because you will be given the same levels of happiness. You'll be provided. Everybody will be equal. Distinctions are removed. And I want to continue driving that home. So where were we at here?
If equity is we're all on the same level,
mm-hmm.
equality is we have equal opportunities to
yeah.
get there.
Yeah, but then there's inevitably going to be some people who do better than others, who are by their merit going to have, let's say, a more flourishing life. They're going to have more things. They may have more freedoms, they may have more property, and they may have a more enriching life, and others, due to whatever reasons, are going to have less. What's that?
Intrinsic motivation.
Yeah, well, I, due to my pre-Christian life, I'm going to say just fallen sinful nature that leads to poor life choices.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, indeed. So, let's see where we're at. So, this. Man, I knew your Christian love was there, brother. I feel it. So, okay, where are we at? Critical race theory favors equity over equality, where equity specifically refers to a particular understanding of social equity theory and not a more generalist notion of fairness. Fairness would be a good way of saying equality. Indeed, it explicitly characterizes the idea of racial equality as a kind of conspiracy theory that leads people, especially people of color, to accept the status quo and their systematically oppressed state of affairs. So the old civil rights movements was basically just to placate the people who were being oppressed, the African-American community in the U.S., to kind of boil that down. Now, this is what I'm going to be...
They say that now about the trans community.
Yeah. You're starting to see the theory applies everywhere, right?
But the theory applies everywhere, but I would say that...
Where they apply the theory everywhere.
The reasons for the equality for African Americans prior to the Civil Rights Movement, I would say that was probably a noble.
Like, watch
I'm
out.
Not saying, I'm not saying the politicians.
Watch out. You're picking up your white man's burden that you're supposed to be enlightening these noble savages.
Well, no, and, because I think, I think everybody can agree that the Holocaust was horrible. I think everybody can agree that Jim Crow South was a bad thing.
And you're using logic and reason again. Yeah, see, you're trying to argue. I know what you're doing. This is.
I know. Where I would say the trans movement is not.
Then you're putting your heteronormativity. You're imposing that on them.
I am.
Yeah, you need to atone, brother.
How long have you been trans? I'm kind of trans.
No. Let's keep it back. Let's keep it on topic. Okay. save that one. Save that one for the parking lot, brother. All right. So.
Just for the record, my birth certificate states I'm female.
Yeah. So yeah. If anybody knows, this is a great story, but let's get back on track here. Otherwise, I'm gonna make you put an ad like a video like, "Hi, my name's Farrell, and I'm a woman" on YouTube.
I'm locking up.
No, please, no.
I was trans before it was cool.
Yeah, but
yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, but I do want to talk to you about after class about this, where that can be problematic, though. It really can be. So you basically prove most of the point of the trans community in that sex is only determined by doctors. I mean, the gender is only determined by doctors and not the actual gender that they have inherently in their system that doesn't align with their biological body. So, yeah.
It's not my fault the Lord made me a man.
Yeah, well, yeah, just you're actually throwing fuel into the, you're actually giving, no, sorry, you're giving your, the bullets to your enemy to shoot at you with that one. All right, so what we talked about deconstructionism and all these terminologies is I'm going to follow up at the end of this slide in this discourse. So critical race theory in its critical legal studies in frustration that legal wins over institutional racism in the 1960s did not more quickly succeed in ending racism or repairing disparate outcomes by race. It draws significant input from the scholars of the 19th and 20th centuries, ranging from Frederick Douglass, W.E.B. Du Bois, as well as black feminists from the later part of the 20th century, including bell hooks, Patricia Collins, and most notably, Kimberly Crenshaw, who coined the term together with her mentor, Derrick Bell of Harvard Law. So the actual term critical race theory. Post-colonial French psychoanalysis, Frantz Fanon, was also a huge significant influence. There are, of course, many kernels of truth within critical race theory or that critical race theory is built upon, but there is little reason to accept that its analysis is serious or rigorous and less reason to believe that its recommendation or recommended solutions can ameliorate rather than inflame racial issues in society. As can be observed in the examples, critical race theory begins with a cynical view that race is the predominant structural element of American and other societies, and that all analyses of race must incorporate systemic power, which is to say systemic racism, that it insists is everywhere, ordinary, permanent, and mostly hidden, a kind of racism that is just beneath the surface. A kind of racism that is mostly beneath the surface. Indeed, it tends to proceed from Derrick Bell's assumption that racism has a permanence to it, and thus is not overcome and does not end, but instead changes forms to something more subtle and harder to find. The consequence of this belief is that racism does not improve in society or stay the same, but actually gets worse by virtue of staying roughly the same while becoming more insidious. One duty of the critical race theorist is to expose this hidden racism wherever it can be found. And that exposition is problematization. And the reason why I went through all that deconstruction part and the talk about moving and shifting of definitions is anytime you have somebody who learns critical race theory and tries to debate one of the theorists, they're going to hide behind this little argument going, oh, we don't practice critical race theory because critical race theory is an obscure legal theory from the 1960s, which it is. But it's also grown and transformed into something much larger. And what they're going to be talking about is this new perception of their critical race theory, which is typically critical race activism, or which they don't even probably name it that at all. But anytime you try to define them, box them into the category, we don't do CRT. Anybody want to see that? There's a interesting debate between Ben Shapiro and I can't remember the name of the, he's a journalist with, I do believe, MSNBC on the Bill Maher show, where Ben Shapiro delivered a very well defined and succinct definition of critical race theory and how it's applied. And the other guy goes, so what? That's not what we're doing. You're talking about stuff 60 years ago. And you'll see the postmodern two-step, the deconstructive change in definitions take place right before your eyes. If you ever want, I'll probably link that to the email I sent out of class, but that's what I'm trying to say and why we can't just say terms, oh, that's CRT or that's cultural Marxism, because they're not going to admit to it. They're going to say they're doing something totally different. And then you've outed yourself as to what your purpose is. You're using reason and rationality. And then now you're in their circle. So that's why I'm trying to say with our normal methods of discourse that we'd even use in apologetics, break down in trying to dialogue. And when I say dialogue, I'm not saying, I'm not going to say we're having a dialectic with this person. Once you're in that dialectic, you're in there, you're playing their game. So we have to use our normal methods of dialogue to address them, which the difference is we're not using their definitions. We won't play their game. We have to constantly play our game. And unfortunately, they've turned reason and rationality against us. Let's see, I'm thinking we're probably not going to be able to make it to the end of this class this year. I'm going to might cut a section out to see if we can probably get as close to the end of the class as possible. So critical race theory begins with core presumptions such as that racism is ubiquitous in American society and its normal state of affairs rather than something that is an aberration or a distortion of what it should be. It therefore believes that all interactions across racial differences must account for the influences of structural racism. Under the first core presumption of critical race theory, the question is not did racism take place, but how did racism manifest in that situation for all social phenomena? That is, the racism is presumed to be present and in need of a critical race theorist to find and point it out. Critical race theory does not just presume that society is fundamentally racist in its very structure, but also that it's intrinsically organized upon anti-blackness, in particular, leading to seemingly peculiar concepts like brown privilege, brown complicity, brown fragility, along the more obvious white privilege, white complicity, and white fragility upon which they are modeled. These posit that white and brown people have a vested interest in anti-blackness because it affords them privilege, which makes them complicit in white supremacy and too emotionally fragile to cope with challenges to social order. In other words, it is a conspiracy theory that everyone and indeed all of society is organized against black people. As a result of this line of thinking, all people within these systems must be aware of and engage their positionality, which is a word we're going to learn in intersectionality, but it's just their position within a hierarchy or hegemony. Their positionality relative to the theorized racial power dynamics intentionally and at all times. In other words, we have to be looking at our own racist behavior, thoughts, and we have to look for it in others and call them out. As such, critical race theory advocates increasing social significance of racial categories in order to engage in identity politics. An example of this assumption being put into action is the Black Lives Matter movement, which springs from the assumption that our police and criminal justice systems are wholly corrupted by systemic racism. Another would be the wide array of nominally anti-racist programs and trainings on offer that are typically mandated throughout much of our society. Critical race theory stands apart from other kinds of theory in that it is usually written quite clearly and has simple tenets. These include the central theme that racism is ordinary and permeates everything. It therefore needs to be uncovered and addressed using critical methods. This is done in the form of theory being applied to historical texts, societal representation, or current discourses. An example of this first includes Derrick Bell's interest convergence thesis, in which he argues that advances have only been made for Black people when it has been in the white people's interest to allow them. This is in fact listed among their core presuppositions of the theory. This causes Bell to argue that the progress of race relations is largely a myth. This is a radical and empirical, although interpreted with a specific ideological bias, approach to critical race theory. The critical study of whiteness is, in this sense, under the umbrella of critical race theory. Now, there's a lot, but I had to get through that to be able to pull out the main ideas. So one consequence of this view is that critical race theory explicitly endorses historical revisionism as it proceeds from the assumption that history was written by dominant white people who have, as a result of their privilege and its influences, not represented it accurately. A contemporary example of this effort is the 1619 Project, which was promoted by the New York Times starting in 2019 with the explicit agenda of reframing the founding of the United States as a project in maintaining and exploiting slavery. That's why I brought up the literary deconstruction. It shows you the revisionism as looking at America, not as in our traditional mythos of our heroes of the founding fathers, but now elevates the oppressed up above and then downgrades our founding heroes, our founding fathers, into being slave owners, perpetuating this white hegemonic system into the very structure, you know, whether it be the Constitution or the laws that spur from them and become structural within the system. So that's why I wanted to bring up the whole idea of deconstructionism. We'll be touching more into that when we get into postmodernism, but that kind of explains this one slide, well, that previous slide.
So that theory also undermines any concept of progress within the race relations.
Mm-hmm.
And so it undercuts the civil rights movement and its promoters.
Yeah, yeah.
So then it basically calls that a lie and that there has been no progress.
Exactly. And then whatever progress there was just because, like, say, either corporate America found that it would be more economically beneficial for them to open up their markets and open up the black market and then dominate, run out the black-owned entrepreneurial businesses and dominate financially over them, or things of similar nature, you know, to be able to just... It could be the white man just trying to present himself as more virtuous or atone for his perceived sins, something of that nature. But yeah, you're getting the concept, but you also see the deconstruction, especially with the historical revisionism, and especially as I tied back to that book 1984, where within the Ministry of Truth, they would constantly rewrite history in order to uphold the generated truth of the party. So all history was altered. And you see the revisionism here as well. So where are we at? Slide 23. So I already got that part. So a strongly postmodern approach to critical race theory also exists. It's currently dominant and owes much to black feminists like bell hooks and Patricia Collins. These scholars sought to understand racism and its connection to gender by making it a multi-layered approach, which included some postmodern concepts about experiential knowledge and multiple consciousness. I mispronounced that. The black feminist legal scholar Kimberly Crenshaw was hugely influential as well and is recognized along with Derrick Bell as the originator of critical race theory. Crenshaw is best known for her concept intersectionality, which describes as a provision a provisional concept linking contemporary politics with postmodern theory. Under intersectionality, race, gender, sexuality, and other matters of identity are seen as cultural constructs in keeping with postmodern cultural constructivism, but in deviation from the radical deconstruction of earlier forms of postmodern thought, oppression on these grounds is seen as objectively real. So, not real, but real, existing only to promote their presuppositions. I'm going to be teaching y'all on intersectionality probably within 3 weeks. Oh, probably let y'all know because we're getting close to the end. No class next week, 4th of July, the day before. I want y'all to enjoy your family. I am, after having been sick for nearly 2 weeks, perpetually behind, so I need to get caught up. That's why I'm stumbling over my words and reading this stuff to you, so I'm not reviewing it. It takes me roughly about 8 hours of research to get the class going, 4 hours of writing just these notes, and then another 4 hours of converting these notes into a presentation for y'all. So it takes a fair amount of time, and I need to get caught up because I don't want to cheat y'all, and I want y'all to come out of this class equipped. So that being said, might run a few minutes later this evening here. I'm probably going to skip over, I'm just going to move straight into what Evelyn was talking about with definitions of racism to move ahead a little bit further so we can get to the end. And then, because in this class, we also have a very strong section on how to address these issues as Christians or through Christianity. So, where am we at? Slide 26. And I'll make these notes available online. Did everybody get the email from last week? Okay, I might need your email again. So, you didn't get it? Why do I have such problems?
The
welcome email, yeah. What's that? All right, everybody check your spam folders. So I get a spam warning even though it comes from me on the thing because it comes from, I do the email through MailChimp, which is an email marketing program so you can broadcast emails out to large groups of people. And a lot of the times those get hung up on spam filters. So check your spam folders. It's going to be from Hondo First Baptist Apologetics. It might be labeled as the Ghost in the Machine. That's my apologetics ministry name. But just go into your spam folders, mark it as not spam, and you should receive it in the future. So sorry about that if that's what's happening. If not, I might have to shift how I'm doing the emails. But in all the emails, I give all the resources I make available to class, plus tons more. If anybody's received them, they know I've got links to other websites. I've got links to documents. I've got YouTube videos and debates. So check your spam folders. I really highly recommend it. All right, so moving on. Critical race theory, moving the goalposts. So we're going to be talking about changes in definitions. So the classic definition of racism is discrimination and prejudice towards people based on their race or ethnicity. Racism can be present in social actions, practices, or political systems such as apartheid that support the expression or prejudice or aversion in discriminatory practices. The ideology underlying racist practice often assumes that humans can be subdivided into distinct groups that are different in their social behavior and innate capacities that can be ranked as inferior or superior. Racist ideology can become manifest in many aspects of social life. Ethnicity is often used as, in a sense, close to one traditionally attributed to race. The divisions of human groups based on qualities assumed to be essential or innate to the group, such as shared ancestry or shared behavior. Racism and racial discrimination are often used to describe discrimination on ethnic or cultural bases, independent of whether these differences are described as racial. So that's the old version. So racism redefined under critical race theory is, as these systems of racial rule recede into the post-civil rights era, what, if anything, has taken their place? Over 100 years ago, the African-American intellectual William E.B. Du Bois predicted that the problem of the 20th century would be the presence of the color line. By that, Du Bois meant that the policies of colonialism and racial segregation were designed to create, separate, and rank various races of men. Until legally outlawed in the 1950s and 1960s, the color line policies of Jim Crow racial segregation kept the vast majority of African Americans from quality educations, good jobs, adequate health care, and the best neighborhoods. In contrast, the problem of the 21st century seems to be the seeming absence of a color line. Formal legal discrimination has been outlawed, yet contemporary social practices produce virtually identical racial hierarchies as those observed by Dubois. By whatever measures used in the United States or on a global scale, people of African descent remain disproportionately clustered at the bottom of the social hierarchy. The effects of these historical exclusions persist today under a new racism. It is important to note that the new racism of the early 21st century has not replaced prior forms of racial rule, but instead incorporates elements of a past racial formation. As a result, ideas about race, gender, sexuality, and Black people, as well as the social practices that these ideas shape and reflect, remain intricately part of the new racism, but in changed ways. The new racism disadvantaged within prior forms of economic organization, a similar outcome exists today. On a global scale, wealth and poverty continue to be racialized. This is permanence. At the same time, racial hierarchy is produced in a context of massive economic, political, and social change that organizes racial hierarchy differently. Excuse me. The processes used to maintain the same outcome are also different. In a similar fashion, ideas about sexuality and gender that were very much part of prior forms of racial rule remain as important today. They too are differently organized to produce remarkably similar results. This is from Patricia Hill Collins, a CRT theorist. So, did anybody understand that at all? No. Does that sound like a form of racism?
No.
Okay. Or does it sound like a form of the idea of using social and economic means to oppress people?
Sounds like socioeconomic.
Yeah. Which is?
Marxism.
Thing. Gold star on your paper today. All right. Okay, slide 28. So from race to culture, the new racism, sometimes called neo-racism, is an uncommonly used term within social justice that means either the same thing as cultural racism or very nearly the same thing. In short, the pessimistic idea of new racism within critical race theory is that older or overt forms of racism, like biological racism and legally institutionalized racism, became unacceptable or illegal largely decades ago. Racism did not end or even diminish much, but changed form to focusing on cultural elements of Black culture, meaning a particular cultural form most common with Black Americans is seen as less valuable and less prone to success than white culture, is steadfastly associated with the people of African descent or origin, and is identified as the primary reason for the persistence of achievement gaps within Black people who have worse outcomes on average than those of other racial groups. And a lot of this comes from This definition comes from, you have immigrants from Africa, especially a huge community of people coming in from Nigeria, Kenya, and the sort, immigrate to America and thrive or earn far more than their African-American counterparts. So then they had to separate out and problematize. Okay, it's not that the people have Black skin. It's now Black American culture that they're addressing now. Right. Because if you have actual Africans with Black skin coming to America and succeeding within the system, it's either a problem inherent with the Africans, which that opens up a host of presuppositions I don't think they're willing to address, which they do in post-colonial theory, but also undermines a lot of their pseudo-reasoning. So, where are we at? Slide 29. Okay. This view is typical of the pessimism about the progress that fundamentally characterizes critical race theory, which often begins with the pillar view that racism is ordinary and permanent in American society, short of a race-based social revolution. Critical race theory maintains that racism doesn't really diminish so much as it gets hidden more successfully, particularly as whites realize that it is in their social and economic interest to mask it. That leads it to takes different, more diffuse forms. These include economic legacies from past eras, in addition to the shift in focus on more subtle aspects like culture. And where you'll hear these is in the arguments that people make towards the existence of systemic racism, typically in the concept of redlining or the Jim Crow laws. But typically these speak to issues that have been made illegal for 40 and 50 years, but they try to say that the legacy of these laws still hold down the Black culture, and they just shifted forms from being something that was overt, meaning it was encoded in the law, into something that that's now, hint, hint, wink, wink, we white people know we're doing this, or we may not, or just so embedded that we don't even see it.
Does this say that all white people are going to realize it's in their social and economic interest to mask it? Are they saying we're all alike?
In essence, yeah, because we are all trying to, well, unless you are adherent to the critical theory and then you've been liberated from your whiteness to a degree. But yeah, you are, by nature of your whiteness and the fragility of wanting to confront your inherent racist proclivities, someone who is going to maintain a system that has you on top, standing on the shoulder, standing on the bodies of the people who hold it up underneath you.
Isn't that person being racist?
Yes, but not under their definition. Yeah.
Would this also be like a Marxism would have been like social security welfare?
Yeah. Yeah. Very much so. Yeah. what's his name? What's his name? Franklin Delano Roosevelt was a socialist. He was madly infatuated with Stalin and all the social changes he was effectuating within the Soviet Union at the time. And you can actually get into, we call it dialogues that Winston Churchill had warning Roosevelt of Stalin's methods and his means and his just sheer evilness, because the British had through their intelligence agencies, had far more of an understanding of what was going on within the Soviet Union than the American intelligence agencies did at that time. So, yeah.
They would. So basically, it was
Something you're going to be used and people are going to throw against you in debates, that you're going to be trying to defend capitalism in some way or form, and they're going to say, America's not capitalist. It's got all these socialist programs going on, and typically they're all New Age deals or something later on by, let's say, the Johnson administration, so on and so forth. And then America's inherently a socialist country, so you're already used to it, so why not just go ahead and take it to its logical conclusion? So, yeah, but then you can just say, why do I have to accept that these systems are here? You know, why should they be here? What have their effectiveness on the culture been? Like, have they been good at lifting people out of poverty, so on and so forth? But yeah, I'm saying this is something, debating these theories, debating Marxists requires having to be not only the conductor of a symphony, but having to be able to play every single instrument in the symphony, meaning you have to know every aspect of philosophy, economics, science, you name it, all the fields of study in order to debate them properly, because they are going to problematize everything and turn it against you because you think you're standing on a foundation of reason and logic, but they see that foundation as being something inherently used as a system to oppress people.
But how often do you run into a fully trained, fully capable Marxist?
Well, I'm in academia, so all the time.
No, but in the real world.
And I've run into him in the corporate America a number of times. One time I was working for a local corporation that had a very good economic footprint on the community before they were later bought by a larger corporation, who had somebody who was in a general work. He was in like order fulfillment, right? Just packing boxes. That was his role within the company. Sit down and have lunch with the dude. Dude was a trained Marxist, working class person, knew the theory inside and out, and would have me scrambling around trying to debate the guy. Friendly as can be, had a really good working relationship with him, but he was a trained Marxist and a blue collar job. So will you run into him? Yeah, you will. Oh, and the majority of them you're going to run into are in your kids' schools these days. Unfortunately, this is where a lot of people were coming out of college, going directly into, been completely brought into the system through their universities where they got their degrees and later their teaching certificates from. So, and we're sending our kids to study under.
More social than it is capital.
they're both the same under Marxism. Let's just leave it at that. Capital, this basic term means, from Latin, meaning, no, head. Capitulum is your head. So each person, each you talk capital, it's human capital, the worth and value produced by the person. That's, you're going to be running that in Marxist theory, but I don't want to get diverted, but they are one in the same. So where are we at? Okay, moving into, okay, I'm going to try to push forward a little bit here. Okay, since the new racism is so profoundly interested in the idea of how racism shifts to culture while insisting that racism hasn't improved, and bears mentioning that reifying race, meaning bringing it up to a high, super high level, through culture is another foundational effort of critical race theory. When Kimberly Crenshaw famously wrote that I am black means something important and more than I am a person who happens to be black, and claimed the difference lies in identifying and forwarding what it means to be black, culturally, especially in terms of systemic oppression, she was creating the platform upon which this issue increases in relevance and becomes salient, especially by the mandate of social justice theory. This move was strategic for Crenshaw so as to complexify and advance identity politics. It was strategically more broadly, at least in part of, because cultures are deemed impossible to criticize under a postmodern rubric of cultural relativism, upon which critical race theory also relies. More specifically, cultures with lower social position with relationships to systemic power, I should be on slide 30, systemic power dynamics in society cannot be criticized or understood properly by those with more, but the opposite is not true. This creates an advantageous double standard that social justice is happy to exploit in virtually every situation. So this is the idea that they can criticize white culture, Western European culture, to no end, but we can't criticize their culture because they're speaking objectively about our culture as if it's something that's universal all white people. The moment we try to criticize any other cultures for having, let's say, issues with that lead towards their being disadvantaged or marginalized, then we are told that culture, everything is relative within cultures. No one culture has more access to truth than another. No one culture has more access to knowledge than the other, or means to be able to present their ethics or knowledge to other people than another culture. So, exactly. So that's the double standard. So back into defining terms, racism as hegemony. The classic definition of racism is individual or institutional practices and policies based on the belief that a particular race is superior to others. This often results in depriving certain individuals and groups of civil liberties, rights, and other resources, hindering opportunities for social, educational, and political advancements. And then the new CRT definition is systemic racism. From a critical social justice perspective, the term racism refers to this system of collective social and institutional white power and privilege. Racism equates to white racial and cultural prejudice and discrimination supported by institutional power and authority used to the advantage of whites and the disadvantages of color, of people of color. Racism encompasses economic, political, social, and institutional actions and beliefs that systematize and perpetuate an unequal distribution of privileges, resources, and power between whites and people of color. Now, critical theory applying to racism. Critical social justice thinks about racism in a systemic fashion, sometimes phrased structural, although this may not mean quite the same thing. Though the system in question remains somewhat ambiguous, roughly meaning everything that happens, critical social justice theory details many specific types of racism under the systemic umbrella, including active racism, passive racism, cultural racism, institutional racism, and aversive racism. It can even refer to a system of knowledge in place. Knowledge itself, or way things are spoken about through discourse. This means that in critical social justice, racism refers less to individual acts of racism and more to ways of the entire system, meaning everything to do with social organization and the way the system manifests privileges to some races while disadvantaging others. I am going to skip forward and because we are running short on time. Moving to here. Okay, so through critical social though critical social justice will still understand racism as the usual. So we're on slide 34. Critical social justice will still understand racism in the usual ways while seeing it as proof of a broader system of racism. It also considers the following examples or proofs of systemic racism in action. Evidence or even claims of any achievement gap between white people, usually non-Asian people of color, especially black people. Under the theory, these gaps could only occur if there is a system of racism that causes them. Thus, even when no discrimination or anti-discriminatory policies are in place, the existence of any disparity in outcomes must still be the result of racism that is hidden mysteriously throughout the system. Two, the state in which no such achievement gap presently exists in any direction, although one against minoritized groups exists in the past. That you see redlining. The lack of an achievement gap favoring minoritized groups here implies reparations have not been paid, which we remember that video we watched earlier, usually through equity initiatives that would favor them. This means the means of identifying the presence of systemic racism is applied when a claim about achievement gaps is shown not to apply or not to be relevant. That is, you will hear this appeal to history when no problem exists in the present. So, in other words, if they can't find any form of racism in the present to make the problematize, they're going to look in the past for proof of racism to problematize and then bring it back and make it a problem in the future. That's what
well,
I'm saying.
You know, like, I'm of German descent, therefore I'm at fault for World War II, for the Holocaust. That sort of...
Yeah, I'm quarter Jewish. I demand you of reparations from you.
Yeah, I mean, that type of logic.
Actually more an eighth, but... So... Supporting idioms, number three, yeah, but you're actually right. Supporting ideologies such as meritocracy, universalism, individualism, human nature, liberalism, the melting pot, and so on. Ah. Where am I at? Dropping everything on the floor here. Okay, we are at four, participation in white culture, which can include keeping to a schedule, working to achieving a meeting agenda, relying upon science, evidence, and reason, which is the master's tools, or over, say, emotion, speaking common parlance English, like saying normal English, and many other things that are definitely not best not racialized, should I say. So number five, seeing race or not seeing race, so damned if you do, damned if you don't. Any six, where are we at? Any racism that flows downward in the direction of power, such as white to brown to black, specifically because a society that allows racism to occur in any form whatsoever must be systemically racist for that to be possible.
Say that again.
There. Specifically because a society that allows racism to occur in any form whatsoever must be systemically racist for that to be possible. So, I don't know if you understand the implications of that, but it's rather chilling. But in other words, racism always flows down from power. So, anytime you, from the direction of power, so anytime you see, you're able to identify power, meaning people having any kind of hegemony, any privilege, any kind of advantage, whether it be economic, whether, say, you come from a good family or you know, like rather than a broken family, are all systems of oppression. So anything that presents unequitable outcomes is racist.
Like I have an education and somebody else doesn't.
Exactly.
I'm racist.
Your parents weren't divorced. You saw this taking place in schools back in the summer of 2020. Where they would, or even that school year where everybody, the few people who actually got to go to school that year, where you had people do these privilege walks. Teachers would take their classrooms out and say, for those of you who come from a family where both parents are married, stand still, take one step forward. For everybody who comes from a family parents went to college, take one step forward. So on and so forth, all these different advantages to show, to demonstrate the privilege that some students had over other students. Those our power dynamics under Marxism and as referenced and distilled through critical race theory. So your parents
are. I remember that, yeah.
Go ahead.
I remember that.
Yeah, so.
So I'm racist because I have a college education, my parents were not divorced, et cetera, et cetera.
You're privileged, but that privilege feeds into a system of. Well, a system of power flowing down from your height of privilege down to those who are disadvantaged. So thus and therefore, yeah, you're racist, especially if the outcomes are that brown to black people suffer from the disadvantages of coming from a marginalized economic or societal, whatever background. They are.
And even like African-Americans who rise up out of the ghetto and, you know, are politically powerful.
Yeah, then they're using the master's tools then. They're internalizing their racism. They're internalizing their racism. They are learning to speak the master's language. They're learning to use the master's tools in order to succeed in a white dominant society. So thus and therefore they've internalized whiteness. That would be typically the epithet cast against them, yeah.
And it totally disregards the other races or the other folks that have that same issue that I'm like. For instance, the Jews.
Or the big target these days are Asian Americans, especially there's, I don't know if the decision's been made in the Supreme Court yet, but a case going to the Harvard Admissions Board that they were intentionally discriminating against Asian American applicants due to the fact that there was a high proportion of Asian Americans making it into Harvard, while black Americans, even though Harvard was using preferential.
Affirmative action.
Yeah, they're using affirmative action measures in order to try to have equitable race outcomes within their enrollment standards. Still, Asian Americans were disproportionately due to the nature of scoring higher on standardized tests, doing very much better in schools and studying diligently. In other words, really wanting to learn, really wanting to be there. Meritocracy, which is a feature of whiteness. So by definition, Asian Americans are white now.
But if you look at it more general, that's not whiteness, that's a superior aspect of the Asian culture above even the whites.
Yeah, but they're in a white dominant culture, so it's.
It's no more than what he's trying to get. Just critical. They start going by race.
Right.
Now it's social.
You have to be a cultural relativist, right? Asian Americans are still considered marginalized groups under this theory. So you can't state it's due to the fact that they're Asian. You have to state it's due to the fact that they've adopted, incorporated systems of whiteness. And then they're using those to advance themselves.
It seems so inherently insulting to every other ethnic. If anything that's successful is white, I mean, that's so insulting.
Yeah. Well, the funny thing is that you heard me use that term, the white man's burden, beforehand, right? This is something I'll use to the theorists. This is the one epithet I'll usually cast them, or the one thing I'll usually smack them with in a debate, is they've taken the white man's burden, attached it to Marxist theory, and they're the ones who are out there trying to liberate the poor, noble savages out of their oppressed systems, and here we come in with our theory that's going to liberate you. And we are the ones who are going to lift you out of that liberation, out of that oppression. Using, so come to us in our new white man's burden.
If I were to move to a different country, I would try to find out what makes that country go and how I can succeed there and with them.
That's the great thing about America, the fact that we're the one country on earth where anybody could come here and. With enough get tutored of this and enough will, they could make a much better life for themselves than they had in the country that they were at before. Whenever you had people come here and they weren't able to do that, it was no longer their fault. They weren't lazy. They and went stupid, or stupid. You know, they weren't any of those things. They were oppressed.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot to be said about that, but there's also a lot to be said that there were certain laws in place in the past, and the theorists are right to the fact that there were laws. The first racist law in place was ironically against Asian people in the West Coast, especially as you had a lot of Chinese people moving into America, and then especially involved with the building of the Transcontinental Railroad. And at a certain point in time, laws were put into place to start to discriminate them. That did happen. We did obviously have Jim Crow laws on the book and certain things. These are things we can't turn a blind eye towards, but they will be used against us. So did we have a truly equal way of opportunity for people? I would say no, but that's not necessarily mean that's baked into the system. It just means that we were operating outside of how the system should have operated at that point in time. So you'll have that used against you. And then Evelyn, to your idea that the idea that people, the moving to these other countries and people incorporate their system. Interesting thing is Marxism did exactly that. Found oppressed groups in every single country in the world.
Absolutely.
In many, many places, yeah, because it uses methodology. So a lot of times, and we're going to run into this in post-colonialism, is a lot of the maps in the world were drawn due to the colonial activities of the European countries, and they did not take into account the actual ethnicities that lie on either side of those boundaries. So you see, basically the Middle East is a hot mess from the breakup of the Ottoman Turkish Empire by the Entente powers after World War II. And then Africa is just in a weird state due to their borders exist from the outcomes of European colonialism in the 18th and 19th centuries. And it has a lot to do with why the countries haven't developed in some respects, but not in all. And that's one of the things is this theory takes the idea of the white culture, white Western European culture being dominant all over all others, makes that its prime presupposition and works out from there. Is it actually something that's happened? Yeah, indeed, it's happened. We can't turn a blind eye to it. We do have to address it directly. But be prepared, it will be used against you, even if you think you're trying to be charitable and debate.
Yeah.
But I want to say we need to move forward. I want to get to a stopping point. We're not going to make it to the end of this class. So there is going to be a part two, but I want to get us to a stopping point on this issue. So where are we at? Okay, so. Okay, number, where are we at? Okay, there you go. Thank you, Evelyn. Okay, not positively liking non-white cultures, especially black culture, or any aspects of these, or not liking them, or liking them while white. So in one way, if you don't like black culture, that's considered racism. You have an aversion towards their cultural. And then if you like them, well, then you're doing cultural appropriation. So, and there's, I'm going to go brain dead again on something. Okay, this is what's called a Kafka trap, to where it's you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. No matter what, you're guilty. And I'll bring Franz Kafka's discourse on that next week, but I don't want to use too much time. So we're already running late, and I just want to get to the end of this slide. So the existence of a word that can be understood as implying or connotating racism, even if the term did not in reality, either because usage evolved or because it never did. For example, the term master bedroom, bathroom, is sometimes given as proof of systemic racism, alleging that it is what slaveholding houses called a room for the master. Though this is not true, the term first rose in a catalog in the 1920s. This type of systemic racism is fundamentally postmodern and that it derives from Derrida's claim that history of a word leaves a trace of its former meaning in present discourses. Apparently, even if that history is an anachronistic fabrication, meaning it's just a lie and it doesn't even match up with the time frame.
Well, I've been calling it primary bedroom.
Yeah. Yeah, and watch, look at any.
No longer the master.
Yeah, look at any floor plans for new built houses. They all don't say master bedroom anymore. Hey, next point. Primary, yeah. Yeah. There's that changing of the language that I've been telling you about. So disagreeing with critical race theory, especially but not limited to, while being white, disagreement with the theories about race is nearly always taken as proof to be upholding systemic racism. So we're all racist right now in this, by nature of we're in this class. Hang on, I'm gonna turn that off. Sorry, online people, I gotta attend to this. Which I don't know how to do with. I'm gonna turn down the volume. That's about the best I can do here. Okay, that's my alarm to tell me I gotta take out the trash when I get home. Yeah. So where are we at? Where are we at? Okay. So okay. Disagreeing with critical race theory, especially but not limited to, while being white, disagree. Okay, I already said that. Okay. The underlying belief is that the theory is only is the only authentic voice speaking about the realities of racism and fighting it, and thus disagreement with this voice upholds racism and thus part of the system of racism. And next point, not believing in theory, critical race theory, or critical whiteness studies, or their claims, especially while white, and crying while white, especially a female, double especially after being accused of being a racist under this systemic definition. And that's typically what would be considered as white fragility, meaning that we don't have the emotional resiliency to confront our own racism. Okay, so I'm going to end this tonight here because we are already half an hour past our normal time here. And then next week we'll continue with this, and then we'll also, this is the good news, is it gives us time to expand on the Christian response to critical race theory, which is very important. So I'm going to go and end the live stream right now.